There was no correlation between independent self-esteem and narcissism. When it comes to generosity, this was probably the most surprising result of the study. People with independent self-esteem were actually more generous and benevolent, both in terms of self-report and in terms of their actual behavior toward other people. A strong sense of self. Remember, love your neighbor as you love yourself. Do not undo others what you would not have done unto yourself. And when you have a high standard for the self, there's a high standard for the other. And that usually happens automatically, because we mirror our behavior toward the I. And then hostility. No correlation between hostility and self-esteem per se, because some people have, with high self-esteem, have high levels of hostility. Some people with high self-esteem have low levels of hostility and more generosity. But dependent and independent self-esteem predicted hostility. Those with high self-esteem that was mostly dependent were more likely, not always, not every person, but on average, were more likely to display hostility. Those people with high self-esteem that is mostly independent were much more open, cooperative, and generous. Perfectionism. Two of my students at that time, Tiffany Gnasiak and Kate Ritchie, who's a TF in this class, did fantastic work showing the connection between perfectionism and self-esteem. How people with high independent self-esteem were less likely to be perfectionistic. Why? Because it's about self-expression. It's about constantly learning and growing, and part of learning and growing is falling down and getting up again. No other way to learn. Whereas dependent self-esteem were more concerned, the words of Mike Moldovano that I quoted last time, we say we want the truth. What we mean is that we want to be correct. More dependent on how they're perceived, more perfectionistic, more afraid of failure. So, this applies also, and we've talked about it before, but I just want to point it out again, to relationships. Best work on the topic, David Schnarch again, where he talks about how do we get to the stage of being known rather than being validated. And that doesn't mean that at the age of 70 or 80, when we're fully evolved, we don't enjoy or need at times the validation of our partner. We do. But at the same time, we're much more about self-expression. Here is what David Schnarch has to say. Differentiation is your ability to maintain your sense of self when you're emotionally and or physically close to others, especially as they become increasingly important to you. Differentiation permits you to maintain your own course when lovers, friends, and family pressure you to agree and conform. Well-differentiated people can agree without feeling like they're losing themselves and can disagree without feeling alienated and embittered. This is what being known is all about. Being yourself, being differentiated. This is what independent self-esteem is. This is what ultimately interdependence is all about. Easier said than done. But again, it's very helpful to have that as a heuristic at the back of your mind, to notice it when it's happening. Because at the age of 20, you're also experiencing moments of interdependence, real connection with a friend, with family, just walking in the yard and admiring the beauty of it all. And these are precious moments that over time we can have more and more of if we follow the natural path, the natural evolution. Going back to the analogy of walking, I mean, very often when we know these, you know, stories through history that people were put in, you know, shoes that were too small for them or were not allowed to try and walk, such as very often the case was in the Romanian under Ceausescu, where people were not allowed to develop naturally. When our natural development is hindered, it can be hindered, we don't evolve as we can. So the question is, also on the psychological level. How can we evolve as we can? And some of the tools that you learned throughout the semester, whether it was the cognitive tool of learning the permission to be human, or the tools that you can actually apply, such as keeping a journal, such as exercising, such as doing the gratitude exercise, such as meditating or doing yoga. All these things, as you'll see, are ways of becoming more self-actualized, of expediting the process. And when we expedite the process, it means that right now, right here, we're able to experience that sense of being much more often. We don't need to wait till we're 50 or 60 or 70. We can be on that healthy journey way before that. So how do we do it? How do we do it? Let me go back to the model we talked about when we discussed change. And we talked about the ABC of change, affect, behavior, and cognition. And I mentioned that the most important approach to change, the most effective approach to change, is the B, the behavior. And I introduced this model of how attitudes change behavior, and in turn, how behavior changes attitude. Remember self-perception theory. If we want to improve one area in our lives, the best thing to do is to behave as we would. If I want high self-esteem, then I need to behave like a person with high self-esteem behaves. Why? Because self-esteem is simply an attitude. It's the attitude I have toward the self. It's the I evaluating the me. And to enhance that attitude, I need to engage, or the most effective way, not the only way, but the most effective way, is to engage in behavior of a person with high self-esteem, which is why it's so important to have role models. And I'm saying that in the plural. It's important to have role models. People that we can look up to and say, I want to have that courage. You know, I want to have the calm and the acceptance and the generosity of spirit that Warren Bennis has. I want to have the passion for teaching that Marva Collins displays. And to create an aggregate of role models so that we can behave and over time achieve that attitude that we're looking for. So let me go over a few of them, of how to enhance self-esteem. We've discussed most, so this is a good summary of some of the things that we went through. First, people with high independent self-esteem generally, as we saw before, from the research, Melissa Christina's research and others, are generally calmer. So independent self-esteem is the attitude, calm is the behavior, which also means that people who behave calmly will increase over time their independent self-esteem. And we see that in related research on meditation, for example, on mindfulness, that as we induce more of it, our self-esteem, and it's the independent part of self-esteem, because I'm not about accolades, oh, I meditated so well today, everyone clap. It's not about that. It's about inducing calm, being centered, being myself. Or physical exercise. Physical exercise induces calm because it releases certain enzymes, certain chemicals in the body. So that over time actually strengthens our independent self-esteem indirectly, because behavior, experiencing the calm, leads to a change in attitude. Imagine that a spell of anonymity has been cast on you. From now on, and for the rest of your life, no one will know what you're doing. No one but you will know how good you are, how generous you are, how benevolent you are. No one but you will know how wealthy and powerful and important you are. You and you alone will know about all your accomplishments. You and you alone will know about how ethical, moral, and wonderful you are. In such a world where a spell of anonymity has been cast on you, what would you do? Familiar, anyone? What would you do? Now, as I mentioned in the response paper, this does not mean that this is what I need to do with my life. what I would do in this anonymous world. What it is saying, though, is that in such a world, or doing this exercise, it can help us hone in on what we would do regardless of the accolades and praise and prestige. I do this exercise regularly. As you know, no exercise in this class that I assign to you is foreign to me. I do them all. I'm going through this class just as you are. And I do this class this regularly. And for example, when I did it as a graduate student here, my response was that in such a world, I actually would not get a PhD. I would not get a PhD because it wasn't that pleasurable to me, very meaningful, but less pleasurable to me. I wasn't that good at it, didn't really feel like I was thriving. But I also said to myself that in our world, not in that world where no one would know what I was doing, but in a world where people know what I'm doing, I would need a PhD in order to teach at a university, which is why I continued and eventually got my PhD. I did this exercise just before I graduated, and I was thinking about different areas to pursue. And I asked myself, what would I do in such a world where no one would know what I was doing? And the answer to that was, I would teach. The answer to that was, I would not do research. That was very clear. And that's when I decided to let go of the tenure track option. Even though there was a lot of pressure on me from the outside, from people who cared about me, and they said, look, two or three articles and you'll get into a great place on a tenure track. You can do it, you know, your PhD can be published. But I knew that that wasn't the life that I wanted to lead. Is there a price for it? Yes. You know, one of the prizes is that, you know, this is my second last class at Harvard. But what kind of world, what kind of life did I want to ask for myself? And that exercise helped me hone on that. What are your passions? What do you really, really want to do with your life? Where do you see yourself 10 years from now or 20 years from now? What's really important for you? What's important for you that you would do regardless of other people's approval, nods, accolades, or cheering, or disapproval, or criticism? What would you do in such a world? It's an important question to ask. People who experience, who have high independent self-esteem, pursue their passions. People who pursue their passions enjoy higher levels of self-esteem. People who enjoy a lot of flow, their independent self-esteem will increase as well. Ask yourself, where do you experience flow? Where do you lose yourself? Is it when you read? Is it over dinner when you're sitting next to your blockmates? Is it when you write? Is it when you stand in front of a class and speak in an after-school program? When do you experience it? When did you experience it in the past? Ask yourself, because that very often is the best predictor of future flow. What kind of life do you want to lead? What do you really, really want to do? People with high independent self-esteem put themselves on the line. They cope. They stretch themselves constantly because they're always about learning and growing, improving, making more of a difference, touching more people. And people who cope, remember self-perception theory, people who cope over time will enjoy higher levels of independent self-esteem. Even if they fall while doing it, even if she says no four times, they get up again and they get stronger. And their independent self-esteem strengthens over time. The graph doesn't look just like this, the ups and downs with the spikes. It looks with the same ups and downs, but with an upward trajectory of well-being, happiness, and self-esteem. Humble behavior, genuine humble behavior. And in one of my favorite texts, and I think one of the most important texts in my tradition, Pirkei Avot, the Chapters of the Fathers, there's a sentence there, a proverb that I've been reading over and over again and never could understand. until I heard an interpretation of a well-known rabbi, Rabbi Noach Weinberg, about this interpretation. And here is the sentence. I'm translating. Those who chase after honor, honor will run away from them. Those who run away from honor, honor will chase them. Let me repeat. Those who run after, who chase honor, honor will run away from them. Those who run away from honor, honor will chase them. And it didn't make sense to me until I put it in the context as a result of the lecture by Rabbi Weinberg of self-esteem. Honor is essentially honoring the self, believing in oneself. And if I'm constantly about chasing honor, the next accolade, the next prize, the next approval, the next validation, then honor will run away from me. And then I will have to push that stone up a steeper incline the next time. And I continue to chase that honor, and I get there, and then the rock rolls back down again. And Sisyphus continues on and on with the incline becoming steeper. Whereas if I run away from honor, behave humbly, over time, honor, true honor, internally generated honor will chase me. Behavior can change attitude. It takes time. And again, at the beginning, as I mentioned to you before, I wanted to be modest, and I wanted everyone to know how modest I was and how humble I was. And then I understood that, well, that's not genuine, but I can still behave and act in a humble way, and over time, it becomes more and more part of who we are. Behavior changing attitude. Doesn't happen overnight. And again, that doesn't mean that a person at 80 who's evolved and actualized does not look for honor as well, does not feel good when he or she is praised. That's natural, part of who we are. This is an important one, and we've talked about it a lot in the class, about simplifying. I've often wondered, why is it that in a country like the United States, such an individualistic country, self-reliant, most of you read it in high school by Emerson, so much about individualism and the self. Why is it that there are such high levels of conformity? Why is it that so many people go on the path that has already been taken and prescribed by others? That doesn't mean that everyone who goes on that path conforms. Again, you can be highly conforming, choosing to work as a consultant or choosing to be a volunteer at a homeless shelter. You can be equally other determined or equally self-determined. It's not about choosing the particular path. But why do we see so many people who conform? And I think it's because of the rat race. I think it's because people in the United States, Western world in general, do not take enough time to reflect and to think about those questions such as, what do I really, really want to do with my life? To ask questions such as, what would I do in a world where no one would know what I was doing? To go through the three question process, the meaning, what is meaningful, what is pleasurable, what do I enjoy, and what am I good at, what are my strengths? To go through these questions and to ask those important questions, because when we take a step back and take the time, that's when we become ourselves, that's when we identify the path that is right for me. Let me illustrate this by showing you a stage model, and this is based on the work of Daniel Gilbert. Indirectly refers to it, his work on cognitive busyness. And what he and others have shown is that people behave very differently when they're cognitively busy, when they're in a hurry, versus when they have time, they can focus on whatever it is that they're doing. So also connected to Tim Kass's work on time affluence. So the first stage is the stage where we don't have time, where we're in a hurry, we're rushed, our reaction is automatic. This is the part where we conform. This is when we conform to the group, as in the Ash experiment. This is when we conform to the man with the white coat telling us the experiment must go on, and we push the button and shock an innocent victim. This is where conformity to obedience, conformity to the group is, when we don't have time, when we're busy, when we don't really think about what it is that we want to do or can do. This is our dependent self, stage one. We very often, at this moment, can reach stage two. Don't need to wait for a long time. At this moment, if we take the time. Because when we take the time, that's when we engage in deliberate reflection, combining reflection and action. Where we think about what we do, we think about what we think. We take our time. This is where the self is autonomous. This is where the independent self-esteem emerges, when we have the time. That's when we're much less likely to conform. That's when we're cultivating and expressing our independent core self. Think of the following experiment. And this cannot be done today, unfortunately. Well, I don't know if it's unfortunate, but it cannot be done today. And that is to retry the Milgram experiment with one difference. Imagine this. So most of you know the Milgram experiment. We've spoken about it here. You're sitting on the chair with your hand on the buttons, or in front of you, you have the panel, and you go up to 60 volts. And there's no real reaction from the other person, the learner. And then you go up to 75 volts in 15-volt increments. And then you get to 120 volts. And the Confederate, whom you think is really being shocked, says, "Ouch, that hurts." And you go and you look up at the person with the white coat, and he says to you, "The experiment must go on." And you go up and up, and the person is screaming and telling you he has a heart condition. And you look up at the experimenter, who looks like this, and he tells you, "I never noticed him until now. I'm glad I never noticed him." He says to you, "The experiment must go on." And you go on. And then they start to whimper and say, "I have a heart condition. Get me out of here." And you look up, and the experimenter says, "No answer is wrong answer. Raise the voltage. The experiment must go on." Now, 63% of participants went above 350 volts, which is beyond the level where the person was not even heard anymore. They continued to shock them until the point of XXX, beyond very dangerous, because he told them that the experiment must go on. Now imagine the same experiment with a slight difference. You give them 75 volts and they say, "Ouch, that hurts." And then the experiment tells you, "The experiment must go on. Why don't you come back in 15 minutes? And you go out for 15 minutes. And you come back again. And it's now at 90. And you go up, let's say, you go up to 120. At 120, the person is screaming, "Get me out of here. You have no right to keep me here." And you look up at the experiment, and the experiment says, "The experiment must go on. But why don't you take a 15-minute break?" What do you think would happen if people were given 15-minute breaks between shocks? Do you think 63% would go to extremely dangerous and beyond? Probably not. Because during these 15 minutes, when they're no longer in a hot state, but rather in a cold state, the words of George Lowenstein, when they're in a cold state, they will think, "Am I out of my mind? What am I doing here?" And they would go and call the police, as opposed to go back 15 minutes later, "Okay, now I'm willing to kill them," which is essentially what they presumably did in that experiment. But when they didn't have those 15 minutes, when it was, "The experiment must go on, the experiment must go on," it went on, and they paid a price. of losing themselves. And this is what happens to us in modern life. No, not with such dire consequences as potentially could have been with Milgram, and we're not doing immoral things, as the case is with obedience to authority. But we're hurting ourselves very often because we're running around and we're conforming. And we're doing what they think we should do. We're doing what that voice or voices are telling us to do. We're not doing what we are meant to be doing. You know what I think the most important part of this class? It's sections and response papers. This is not out of modesty. Yes, I want you to think I'm modest, but that's not why I'm saying it. It's because that is when you get the time to reflect, to talk about it with your teaching fellows, with your fellow students, to think about it. You're quote-unquote forced to take a time out. It's when you sit down and write those response papers about these questions that I mentioned. That's when your real autonomous, shining self comes out. It's when you talk to your friends about this class or your blockmates in the dining hall. When you take the time to share it with your parents. That's when it is happening. Finally, integrity. Nathaniel Brandon did this with many of his clients. He's a therapist, where he would bring them in and tell them, okay, for the next week, stop, no lies, be fully integrated, be fully honest. And what he found was when he applied it, especially to people who would lie a little bit more, that enhanced their self-esteem. I remember back in 1990, I think it was 96 or 97, when the whole Clinton impeachment trial was going on CNN, they brought on DePaolo. She's a professor at the University of Virginia. And she does research on lying. And they interviewed her, and it was the first time I was exposed to her work. And she said on CNN that her research shows that basically everyone lies. Many times little lies intended to impress others, many times bigger lies. And what she found was that people lie on average about 3 times a day. And when I heard it, I scoffed. I said, well, maybe other people lie 3 times a day. I don't lie. And let me explain to you why I don't lie. And this is true. Because I wrote my senior thesis in college on the concept of honesty pays. I was a joint philosophy and psychology concentrator, was interested in ethics, self-esteem, motivation. And what I showed, based on research, based on philosophical works by Aristotle, by Adam Smith, that we pay a high psychological and emotional price whenever we lie, whenever we cheat, when we're dishonest. And then I said to myself, but let me try DePaolo's exercise. What she does is have people evaluate their conversations for honest or dishonest content right after it finishes. So when it's still fresh in their mind, what they talked about. So they keep a journal which is completely anonymous. So I said, but I'm going to do it, even though I don't lie, because I know the consequences of lying, because I wrote my thesis on it. I'm an expert on honesty. I said, I'll still do it. Because I like to try experiments. As it happens, I went on a date that night. Someone whom I'd never met before, it was not Rena. Someone whom my mom set me up with. My mom and her mom taught together in the same school. And I heard wonderful things about her. I was very excited. I became even more excited when we met. And we were sitting down having a lovely dinner and talking, and she's an economist, very successful economist, and she asked me what I was doing, and I told her that I was a psychologist, and I was really impressing her with all my knowledge of psychology. And then she said, you know, I'm also interested in psychology, and I said, this is going really well, to myself, not to her. I learned not to say those things on earlier dates. So we were sitting down and learn to fail. So we were sitting down and talking, and then she said, "Oh, you know, I just read about the psychologist," and she said the name, and you know, the very famous psychologist. You know him, right? Now, I didn't have the faintest clue who she was talking about. No idea. And I remember pausing for a second and looking at her and just smiling. And the conversation continued to flow. Now, I would not have noticed this, except for the fact that afterwards I went home and went over the conversation. Sunny said, "Hey, wait a minute. I just lied to her." And ever since then, I've been doing this regularly. Lying, that is. I've been doing this regularly. Ever since then, I've been doing the integrity exercise that DePaolo talks about, that Nathaniel Brandon talks about, to be very conscious of my conversations. Am I just saying things to impress, which are not authentic? Am I having those little lies? Because you see, when we are telling the truth, the message we communicate to ourselves, is that my words are worthy, my words are important, I matter. And when we don't do that, when we tell lies, or when we're about impressing constantly, we're saying, "I'm not good enough as I am. I need to be someone else so that the other person likes. I need to know that psychologist, because otherwise she won't like me." Instead of being authentic and real. Instead of being known rather than validated. And doing it and being conscious of it for a week at a time, until the behavior changes our attitude. And I begin to value my words much more when I communicate myself who I am rather than try and impress others. When I assert myself, when I say no at times so that I can simplify my life a little bit. When I say yes when it's appropriate, even if it's not the most popular yes in the world, but it's right for me. And it's about expanding it in time as well as in space. It is starting, first of all, by myself. Why does journaling help so much? Why does therapy with an empathic therapist, why does it work so well? Because we're ourselves. We don't try and impress the therapist after a while. We open up. We don't try and impress our journal. We are ourselves. And expanding it from our journal, which makes us feel good, to close relationships, to others. From doing it one day, one conversation at a time, to a week of integrity treatment, so to speak, to lifelong. Imagine leading this life. How freed up do we feel when you no longer need to express or impress ourselves constantly? Where we can just be known. Where we can just be ourselves. How much lighter, how much more power, how much more integrity and authenticity will we experience? How much happier will we be? I want to end by reading you an excerpt from Melissa Cristino's journal, which she cited in her senior thesis. This, of course, is with her permission. Melissa Cristino was an undergraduate here, class of 2002. And this is what she writes. "Your true potential lies way, way down in the depths of your soul. In the pit of your stomach, past your knowledge, beyond your nervousness, and buried under your fears and anxieties. As hidden as it may be, it is still there. I know it's there because I've felt it before. And I know it's there in others, too, because I've seen others perform miracles. There is a faint glow of unparalleled potential in all of us, and when we find it, it shines. It's there in each and every one of us, this glow. And if we feed it, if we cultivate it, it grows. And it grows to the level that it expands beyond the self, where people like Warren Bennis, where people like Nelson Mandela, were people like Anita Roddick, people like Mother Teresa. Just their presence, their being, shines a light onto others. So what I'd like you to do now, we have 4 more minutes. Here is what I'd like to do now. I'm going to play a song for you. Usually play it at the beginning, I want to play it at the end today. If you feel comfortable, you can close your eyes and listen to the words of the song and what they mean to you. What they mean in the context of your life. So if you feel comfortable, close your eyes and listen, really listen, to the following words.
I am what I am. I am my own special creation. So come take a look. Give me the hook or the ovation. It's my world that I want to have a little pride in. My world, and it's not a place I have to hide in. Life's not worth a damn till you can say, I am what I am.